Hey guys, I'm Fred from Pretty Fly Games, and today we're going to build a simple top-down 2D car controller in Unity. This controller is suitable for arcade-style games, so let's get started. Alright, so in Unity I've set up a simple 2D project where I've added a simple road. From this we will create our car object, and it will just be a regular game object that we will call car. And from the sprites we will drag the car sprite and put it just on the car object, and we'll rename it to sprite, and we will put it on the center of the game object at 0, 0. We will also make sure that the car is on the 0 of the z-axis, and we'll just move it to the road. We will be using Unity's built-in physics, so let's add a rigid body component. And we will keep most of it as it is. We will just change the angular drag to 0.1. And we will remove the gravity scale, because otherwise the car will just fall off the screen. And we will change the interpolation to interpolated, so it becomes a little bit more smooth when we move it. All right, then we will need our car controller. So let's create a script for that. And let's edit it in Visual Studio. In Visual Studio, we will start by adding a few variables, and we'll make them into public so we can change them from the editor. So we start with car settings. We will need an acceleration factor, how fast the car will accelerate when we hit the acceleration button, and a turn factor, how fast the car will turn when we actually try to change direction. And from this, we will need a few local variables. The first one is the acceleration input and the steering input. And then we will also need a rotation angle, so we know how to rotate the car basically. Also, we will need access to the rigid body component in Unity. So we will add a reference to that. And I prefer to actually attach them myself through the awake function. So we will use the wake function basically to get the component of the rigid body instead of assigning it through the inspector in Unity. All right. As we're using Unity's built-in physics, we need to use the fixed update rather than the update function. And in our fixed update function, we will add two new functions. One to apply engine force and another to apply steering. In the apply engine force, we will start by creating a vector, which will be the force that we will be applying to the car. And we will take the transform up, which is the 2D equivalent of forward. We will use an acceleration input and multiply it with an acceleration factor. Now, we also need to apply this to the physics through the rigid body. So we will apply a force that will push the car in the forward direction. In this function, we will change the rotation angle of the car. And Unity themselves often recommend that you don't mess with the angles directly, rather that you use different type of forces to manipulate them. But when it comes to steering, I find that having exact steering is something that I really enjoy in car games, and it feels a little bit sluggish when you're using the forces. So we will change the angle directly, but we will actually use the move rotation, which is slightly better than just changing the rotation value directly. All right, then we will need to be able to have a way to actually set the input vectors so we can turn the car. So we will just add a simple set function for it, which sets the variables based on input vector. We will then add another script to handle the input of the player, basically. So in the car input handler, we will add a reference to a component, the top-down car controller, and we will use the wake function again to get a, well, get that component. We actually don't need a start, so we can remove that. And in the update function, we will collect the input from the user, and we will use Unity's built-in features for that. So we will just create a vector2 input and then grab the axis horizontal and vertical and store them. And then we will use the setInput function of the top-down car controller to update the input vectors. All right, great. In Unity, we will assign the scripts to the car object, and we will basically just drag them into the game object. And now we should be able to play the game. So as you see, the controls are very floaty, and the car is, well, like floating in space, basically. So this pretty much feels more like a space game than a car racing game. So we need to change a few things because we're not making a space game today. And the reason for this is because there is basically no friction of the tires. So we need to add that. If we look at the physics involved this, it's quite complex. We have four tires and the car and the center of the car and the mass. As the car turns, we have a bunch of forces acting on the car. It's frictions on the tires, it's the sideway velocity of the car, it's the forward velocity, and it's all very complicated. But we want to make a very simple car controller, which is an arcade-based car controller. So we will basically disregard all of these forces and focus on two: the side velocity, the orthogonal velocity, and the forward velocity. When the car turns, the side velocity increases, which causes it to drift. And right now it drifts far too much, which we see when we play the game, and it feels more like a space game. So what we will do to eliminate this in a very simple way is we will kill part of the side velocity, which will cause the car to drift less. If we kill it completely, it means the cars will go on rails basically and not drift at all. So let's code that. Let's open Visual Studio again, and we will start by adding a new variable that is called drift factor, which controls how much the car should be drifting. Then we will add a new function called kill orthogonal velocity. And basically what it will do is it will remove part of the side forces as we turn the car basically. And the first part is that we need to calculate how much forward velocity the car has. And the forward velocity, we calculate that by taking the transform up and multiply it with the vector 2 of our dot product with the car's velocity and up. That basically gives us a value how much forward velocity a car has. Then we need to calculate how much is the car going in sideways, and we do that by calculating the right velocity. And we take the transforms right, multiply it by the vector 2 of this of the right component instead. All right, so now we have the two vectors, basically the forward velocity and the right velocity. And what we will do is that we will change the velocity of the car, and we will remove part of the right velocity based on the drift factor. So if we have a drift factor of 0, it means that it will not drift at all. It will basically run on rails. If we have a high drift factor of 1.0, then we will have the same spacey float as we saw before when we played the game. Now with a 0.95, we will have some drift, and it will be rather arcadey. So let's try that. Awesome. See, that feels better already. And we're not quite done yet though. So we do have some rather strange things. It feels drifty and it's nice, but we can do this, which cars usually can't do. So we need to fix that with the steering. So let's go back into Visual Studio and look at the top-down car controller script. The apply steering function is what is causing this problem, because the user is allowed to turn without moving forward. So we will add a minimum factor of the speed before allowing to turn. So what we do is take the car's velocity and divide it by 8. That's a value that I picked because it feels good. You can change that value if you want to. What we do then is we clamp this down into between 0 and 1, so we get a factor from it. And then when we are rotating the angle, we are multiplying it by this factor. So that means if the car is moving at velocity 0, this whole equation will become 0, so it won't rotate. Let's see how that works in Unity. Right. Awesome. It does not rotate when the car is standing still, and if it's moving very slow, it can't rotate that much. So this is looking way better. But then we have some weird things, some additional weird things that we need to fix, like that the car is actually not slowing down when I let go of the accelerator button, and it never actually stops. So let's fix that. So let's go back into Visual Studio and open the top down car controller again. We want the car to stop when the user lets go of the acceleration button. So we will add a drag, and that will basically slow down the car when there is no input. So we have 0 acceleration input. Then we will increase the drag to 3 over time, and if the user hits the accelerator button again, either in the positive or negative value, then we will remove the drag. This causes the car to stop slowly when you let go of the button, basically. So let's try that in Unity. Okay, so now when I let go of the input, it slows the car down. And I can also do some pretty cool things, like if I start to turn and drift like so and let go of it, it will also slow down. So it makes it possible for me to make even more tight turn by letting go of the accelerator button. Sort of like in the real world, but much more arcadey. Another thing that is missing in our car controller is a maximum speed. Let's add that in the script. We'll start by adding a public float called maxSpeed. And then we'll actually add another variable called velocity versus up, which we will use later on, and it's handy to have that one. So let's go to the apply engine force. In this function, we will calculate how much forward the car is going in terms to it of its velocity. This is useful to limit the speed of the car, but also other things that we'll use in the future. Let's start with a limit. So if the car is going forward and its speed is bigger than the maximum speed, and the user is pressing the acceleration button, then we will not apply any more force. We will return from this function. Then we want to be able to do the same thing if the user is reversing. So we will limit it so it actually can just go half the speed when it's going backwards. And then we have another case where the car is basically going sideways when we are sliding or doing anything like that, or getting pushed by another object. Then it could be that we are actually accelerating and passing our maximum speed. So we'll add a test case for that as well, saying that if the square magnitude is larger than speed times speed, and the user is pressing the accelerator button, then we will also return. Now, with these changes, our car controller is pretty much complete, and we have a lightweight arcade-style car controller that can be used in any type of project. In the description, we've added the source to this game, so you can try it out on your own and change the values to find something that suits you and your car project. Hopefully, we'll see some pretty cool arcade games coming out of this project. Next video, we'll focus on polishing up this game a little bit by adding tire marks to the game, some smoke particle systems, and also some sound effects. Hit that subscribe button if you want to get a notification when the video is ready. Here's an example from our game, Total Arcade Racing, which uses this component for its physics. You can find the game on Steam and take it for a spin if you want. Thanks for watching the video, and I hope that you enjoyed it.